The much-anticipated Ukrainian counter-offensive has so far achieved little. What many experts have feared for long is gradually turning into reality. The war is likely to result in a frozen conflict or an apparent truce. The latest announcements that Denmark and the Netherlands will deliver F-16 fighter jets to Ukraine are also unlikely to change this scenario. Some voices in the West have already started to suggest that Ukraine give up land for NATO membership, an idea that Ukraine has called ridiculous. Meanwhile, Russia is trying to win new friends at the BRICS summit and is yet again blaming the West for Ukraine's fate. So, on to the point, we are asking, land for peace. Should Ukraine concede territory to Russia? Hello and welcome to the point. I'm Isha Bhatia-san here in Berlin. Ukraine is fighting a tough battle. Meanwhile, the news of Wagner chief Prigozhin allegedly being aboard a plane that crashed in Russia has caught everyone's attention. So how will things turn out for Ukraine now? To understand this, I have three spectacular guests with me today. We have Miriam Kosmehl. She's expert on Eastern Europe at the Bertelsmann Stiftung. Next on the panel is Commander Göran Swistek. He is visiting fellow at the German Institute for International and Security Affairs, SWP, and writes extensively on military and security issues. And joining us from our headquarters in Bonn, we have Roman Goncharenko. He works for DW's Russian desk and has been reporting since the beginning of the war in Ukraine. A very warm welcome to you all. Thank you for joining. Miriam, Ukraine is struggling. Russia is trying to win new friends at BRICS. And then we have this news about Wagner chief. How is all this developing? How will all of this affect the war now?
I do not think that what has happened to Prigozhin will affect the war directly. I think that Russia's picture is in South Africa weaker as Vladimir Putin would wish for. You said he is looking for new friends, certainly so. And he has certainly, over the past weeks before this plane crash, seen to it that the situation in Africa is prepared somehow with the major commanders of the Wagner group, where it has been very active, so the Central African Republic, Libya, and so on, to kind of like get this under control. But at the same time, he is abiding by the global rules that he is mocking by not appearing in person. So at least he's not reaching out to new friends from a strong position.
Not from a strong position. Roman, I'd like to know from you, how are the reactions in Ukraine to the plane crash now?
Well, the reactions were rather reserved, I would say. Of course, many people were very, very happy because Prigozhin and his Wagner group have killed a lot of Ukrainians since 2014 when they first were sent to Ukraine to fight in Donbas, and some of them also participated in the annexation of Crimea. But in general, the feeling is that the cracks in the Russian system of power that became visible during the Prigozhin mutiny, that they will remain. And the hope is that someday they will be bigger. And of course, Ukrainians follow the situation inside the Russian military. And Prigozhin had at least some supporters there. He was criticizing the Russian defense minister, Sergei Shoigu, and Vladimir Putin refused to remove him from his position. So when Shoigu stays, this will, in the short or middle term perspective, will weaken the Russian army because he's not popular, and if he stays, this will undermine the Russian war in Ukraine. But for the moment, the situation seems stable for Moscow.
Mm-hmm. We'll probably hear more about the reported plane crash in the future. I'd like to understand about the counteroffensive and where the war stands as of now. Is it already a frozen conflict? Would you say that?
I wouldn't say this. In our society, we often have the picture in mind when we speak about a counteroffensive that we see two forces on the battlefield clashing at each other. But military operations work differently, totally differently. You have aspects to you need to take into consideration, like psychological aspects, logistics, etc. And I think what I can observe from the Ukrainian counteroffensive is that is a developed plan that takes these effects into consideration. They work with signaling, they work with psychological effects, they target also the logistics behind the battlefield. So all these other aspects have a very important momentum, and this momentum can be much bigger than the actual clash on the battlefield. And I think that's the point where the Ukrainian forces are working on to create these effects in order to weaken then the Russian side on the battlefield.
And to regain the territory taken from it by Russia, Ukraine needs more sophisticated systems like the F-16 fighter jets and the Taurus cruise missiles, while Moscow has repeatedly warned against the delivery of such weapon systems.
A fierce fight for every single square kilometer. Russia and Ukraine both report successes. It's difficult to say which reports are accurate. What's certain, the Ukrainian counteroffensive has not been as successful as hoped. However, Ukrainian President Zelensky was able to announce one success this week. Ukraine is getting F-16 fighter jets. Denmark and the Netherlands have promised to deliver around 60 to Ukraine. It will take months before they are deployable, which isn't the breakthrough needed for the ongoing offensive. Ukraine also wants German Taurus cruise missiles, with no agreement in place yet. These missiles can fly hundreds of kilometers far into Russian territory, which is why Germany is still reluctant to supply them. For weeks, the German government has been assuring Ukraine that they are assessing the situation. Could F-16 fighter jets and the Taurus cruise missiles bring new momentum to the counteroffensive?
Göran, what is it that the F-16s and the Taurus missiles can do that other weapon systems can't?
Well, several aspects here as well. Let's start with the point of the F-16s. After the decision now made to deliver F-16s from Netherlands and Denmark, it will take up to half a year approximately until they are delivered, until the pilots are trained and you can see them in Ukraine. It is a very political signal, I would say. It's not military necessary, I would say, because currently there's no air dominance for Ukraine around its territory. So flying these aircrafts, operating them, is very dangerous. They can be easily targeted from the Russian side. So at the moment, other systems would be more necessary. Air defense systems, ammunition, etc. But the momentum here, the political signal is we continue with the support. There are new weapon systems we are delivering. So it's more a political signal than a military.
And why are those systems not being discussed then?
They are, but I think with the ammunition and the other air defense systems, we are already looking into scare capacities in the other countries because we delivered so much ammunition already. Our economy is not at the point where we can deliver constantly more. It needs to be reproduced. Also, the air defense system, the IRIS system, is a very complex system that needs a certain time to be produced. So it's nothing we have on the shelf to deliver.
But you say it's a political decision. Then why did it take for the US so long to give permission for the F-16s?
Well, a very important point from the Biden administration, or for the Biden administration, is not to escalate. They all always say this. And what they say is also they don't want to have NATO getting into an escalating situation with Russia. And also on the second aspect here, the second thing we need to look at is the main focus of the Biden administration is still in the Indo-Pacific with China. So they don't want to be involved too much into Europe. So that's why they are hesitant to bring more material, more troops maybe, or more commitment at least to Europe, because they have a focus on the other side of the globe.
Miriam, Göran just said that it will take a long time for the F-16s to be delivered. Now, this is not the first time that it's going to take this long. There have been other promises in the past. And the Ukrainian side is already showing frustration that they haven't been given stuff that they've been promised. Why is everything taking so long?
Because in our political considerations, it has not been taken account of the fact that things, as Görens just said, need time to actually be there and be made available. And that is a flaw that has been going through our way of accompanying Ukraine and supporting Ukraine. And rightly so, Ukraine is disappointed or pointing to the fact that this is leading to very concrete losses of human beings on the battlefield. Because, as a matter of fact, what is happening right now is that Ukraine is fighting in an offensive, which is always more risky and more difficult. But on top, it is fighting in a already difficult territory that has been so heavily mined, as I don't think there has been an example in warfare, or maybe long back, Erwin Rommel in Africa, but it's really it's a very drastic challenge. And plus, analysts have said that Ukraine is being expected to fight in a way that NATO would never fight, because they are demining, and or they are trying to break through the defenses that Russia has been building up in the time it took to supply certain weapons. And they are doing that without air superiority, which is a reason for their losses. And of course, we are not only talking about such long-length missiles and cruise missiles, but there is also not there are not so many or not sufficient attack helicopters. And they are kind of like picking those that Russia has, but some are still available. So that's why.
Are you both suggesting that this is more of a symbolic help than a real one?
I'm not saying it's symbolic, but it's not enough.
It's not enough. I'd like to go to Roman now. It's not enough, but West has been supplying weapons, although the pace has been extremely slow. But how do you see this, the dependency that Ukraine has on the West because of the weapons? Doesn't that kind of give the West a certain power to decide what Kyiv's policy should be like?
Well, the West is already in very close talks with Ukraine as what the policy should like, but it's Ukrainians who have to decide how they continue. So, speaking about weapons, yes, the West has been delivering a lot of weapons to Ukraine, but it's not enough, as the we've just heard. I totally agree with that. When I was last time in Ukraine in spring, I asked about F-16s, the Ukrainian soldiers and officers, and they told me, we need them a lot, but we don't think that this will be a kind of a magic silver bullet. So they don't believe anymore that any kind of single weapon will decide the course of this war. So they just need tanks and artillery and shells for those tanks and artillery, as well as the F-16s. So it's a war of attrition. And not a frozen conflict. And in a war of attrition, to win it, Ukraine needs sustainable weapons deliveries. This is what has been promised to Ukraine in Vilnius at the NATO summit, but something that is being questioned now in the American press. So the question is, maybe we will not support you as long as it takes in the end. This is the question mark. So we do not know the answer to that question. The sources are anonymous in the United States media. But with the presidential campaign next year starting now, we will hear more and more such voices probably. And this is what worries Ukraine. Ukraine is worried about how steady will this flow of weapons be from the West. And maybe this is the reason why the President Zelensky, in his address on the Independence Day in Ukraine was talking more than usual about the Ukrainian local production, about Ukrainian own weapons developed. And we've seen that those weapons were successfully used in the Black Sea attacking Russian ships.
So on the one hand, we are talking about help from the West, and on the other hand, the West seems to be getting impatient. A close associate of the NATO Secretary General, Stein Jensen, recently said in an interview that Ukraine should give up part of its territory for peace and get NATO membership in return. Though he did apologize for his comment later, the statement caused a stir.
Land for peace, a statement that had not come from Brussels, NATO's headquarters so far. Should parts of the territories in the south and east, annexed in violation of international law since 2014 and now contested, be ceded? Ukraine is currently fighting to recapture them. This proposal is unimaginable for the president. We are ready to exchange Belgrade for our membership in NATO. Dark humor, as Belgrade belongs to Russia, not Ukraine. NATO Secretary General Jens Stoltenberg attempts to assuage the tension. What is decisive is the Ukrainians themselves must make the decision. They must decide when the prerequisites for negotiations are present and what an acceptable solution is. Is exchanging territory for Ukraine's membership in NATO just a misunderstanding? Or is there more to it?
How do you see that? Was the statement really blown out of proportion, or is NATO working on a plan B?
I would say it's not an official NATO position. In the run-up to the Vilnius summit of NATO earlier this year, many scenarios have been discussed, because one of the main points on the agenda, dominating the agenda of the summit, was NATO membership for Ukraine. So the allies discussed scenarios, if this could happen, how it could happen. And at the end, one of the major points made by the US, but also by Germany, as long as the war is going on, NATO or Ukraine will not become part of NATO. That was one of the major points. So other allies then, on their national or bilateral initiative, developed scenarios how they could support, provide maybe security guarantees, security support to Ukraine. There have been several ideas coming out from the Baltic states, Lithuania, but also other countries. Macron gave an interesting speech in Bratislava for security guarantees or about security guarantees. So there have been some initiatives what countries are considering or planning maybe, but not in a NATO framework currently.
So it's not an official option, but it is one of the options being discussed off the table.
I think all options should be on the table and discussed. Otherwise, you are unprepared for what might come. In the end, many people think, and I think that would be where the Biden administration, but also our current German government, is looking for, having a short-term solution, a quick solution for the conflict with negotiations, maybe, if the situation would be right, if Ukraine armed forces could achieve a momentum where Russia then goes back from its aims, targets in this war, and says, okay, we will sit at a table. That's probably one scenario they are thinking about it, but it's not guiding principle currently, at least not for NATO.
Miriam, Stoltenberg's words, only the Ukrainians can decide. Who is really going to decide the fate of the war? Zelensky, or is it Putin?
It's not only Zelensky, it's the Ukrainian people who in almost unisono have said that that is not this so-called land versus peace proposal, that that is out of question, because it's not territories, it's people living there on these territories and having suffered human rights violations and atrocities since 2014. And it's not peace either, because there is no concept what to do with Russia. I mean, Russia is not changing. Putin is not reconsidering his approach at all. His words stand that he sees Europe in 1997 terms, and it's a threat to European security, what he is continuously doing, and to global security, because it has also an after effect if we accept that subjective or that out of order moving of borders. I do not think that that is something that, or I am sure that is not something that Ukraine can accept, but I am also sure that that is not something that we can accept because of the reasons I just gave.
So can there be a peace treaty then?
There can be a peace treaty, but only, as Roman Goncharenko has rightly said, it's a vicious war of attrition, what we have right now. And only if that war leads on the battlefield to a situation that makes Putin reconsider, we then have the opportunity to actually go into negotiations, but not in that situation right now.
If you talk about a peace treaty, the only peace treaty I currently can imagine would be if Russia leaves all occupied territories. That's what also the aims of the Ukrainian side is, having its occupied territories back. So that's the only position currently where I can see a peace treaty. Other than this, it will be either a war of attrition, or we create, or Ukrainian forces together with the support from the West, we create a momentum where Ukraine can achieve on the battlefield, but also aligned with other operations in the information space, in the psychological space, effects to toggle the Russian armed forces.
Meanwhile, President Vladimir Putin has used the BRICS summit to defend and justify Russia's war in Ukraine. Putin went on to accuse the West of unleashing the war.
The emerging economies want to form a counterbalance to the prosperous West. BRICS countries account for about 40% of the world's population and about a quarter of the world's economic output. The BRICS countries could grow. More than 40 countries are interested in joining. Russian President Putin joined only by video call. He was facing arrest on an international criminal court warrant. For Putin, it was an opportunity to show that Russia has powerful allies. Is the BRICS alliance as influential, cohesive, and powerful as it seems? Could the geopolitical world order be on the verge of fundamental change?
Miriam, none of the BRICS member states have taken any steps against Russia. We heard 40 countries are now interested. Six, we heard this morning, have been approved. Now, is Putin trying to use BRICS as a shield?
Of course he is trying it, but let's see to which extent it will be successful, because after all we are talking about a group of countries that for themselves have serious considerable differences, and we have the three democracies and we have Russia and China, and we have conflicts between China and India, and we do not have serious peace proposals, plans, neither proposed by China. It's, by the way, a shortcut we would have wished for, because we did see or do see China as a powerful, as a regional power that could influence Russia, but they decided not to do so. So back to your question, Putin is trying, but to whether extent it will work will also, I think, depend on us. But I don't think it will work as smoothly, because South Africa and also Brazil, I don't think they see themselves as on the Russian side. They see themselves as swing states following their interests.
I would say more fence sitters, not swing states. They're observing what's going on, but they're also bringing in their own position into this. Like the African Initiative, when they went to Ukraine and Moscow for peace. And while they have been in Kiev, Kiev was attacked by the Russian side. So I think, especially South Africa, has a strong position on this war. But also Brazil, if you look on the statements from the Brazilian president, you see that's not a united bloc, the BRICS, yet, even if Russia would wish it.
I'd like to go to Roman before we conclude the show. Roman, Russia is likely to host the BRICS summit next year. How is that being perceived in Ukraine?
Well, Ukraine is currently preoccupied with the war and is trying to pull at least some of the BRICS countries on its side. We see more Ukrainian diplomatic activity on the African continent, which was kind of neglected by the Ukrainian authorities in the past years. If I may, just two or three brief remarks to what we've been discussing about this proposal to exchange land for peace. I think it's a very dangerous discussion because it undermines the Western and Ukrainian efforts to stop this war. Just remember, the West said before supplying those heavy weapons, those tanks to Ukraine, that Ukraine should be in a position, in a stronger position to negotiate with Russia. We are not there yet. The fighting continues, and that's why Ukraine needs more weapons, not discussions about giving up, because Vladimir Putin is just waiting for the West to blink, so to say, and then he thinks that he has more resources, right, and then he will win in a year or two.
Thanks, Roman. Now, will any of the BRICS member states be able to get a peace deal signed between Russia and Ukraine? That needs to be seen, or will Ukraine have to give up territory? What do you think about it? Do let us know your thoughts on YouTube. Thanks for watching. Goodbye.